Yo, what's up? I'm Adam.
And I'm Aaron.
Aaron, thank you so much for joining us. Tell us really quick who you are and what you do.
Yes, I'm Aaron Merrill. I'm a product manager on the Wendlink team, and I focus specifically on security for Wendlink. So how do you keep your data safe once you've stored it in Wendlink?
And it's ironic that you're here because in this video today, we want to talk about some of those security things or things you can do to protect data that's inside of Wendlink or how you manage that and all of that. So thinking about like the file and folder access items with inside of Wendlink, like why are we doing that?
Yeah, so oftentimes you have lots of data within your lakehouse maybe, and you don't want to give users access to all of the data in your lakehouse. There might be specific folders, maybe it's some unstructured data. You just want to give them access to a specific item.
Excellent. All right, so how do we get started with this? What do we do?
Well, let's go ahead and head on over to my machine and we can take a look.
I love it.
So I'm here in my lakehouse. I have current tables and some folders here as well, some unstructured data, some training JSONs and some PDFs maybe that I'm going to use for training a machine learning model. And then at the top, I have this button for managing my Wendlink data access, a public preview feature. And when I click this, I get a page where I can see all of the different roles that exist in my lakehouse to grant access to items. When you first turn this feature on, you'll see just kind of a default role. So this keeps all of the existing functionality that we had prior to the preview, where users could have access at everything in the lakehouse or nothing. So to start, let's go in here and let's just remove the default role. So now all of my people who have viewer access or just have this lakehouse shared with them directly, they're not going to have access to data. So we want to go ahead and add some users to this role. So we're going to create a role here. And this is going to be for some of our sales information. We'll just call it the sales role. And then I have the option to say, let's grant this access for all items in the lakehouse. That's what the default beta role was using. That's really not the goal of this. So we'll go ahead and click selected folders. And here I can just really easily pick and choose the items that I want to grant access to. Here are some of the sales items that we want to include. Marketing folder. You'll notice that a lot of the data that I pulled in are shortcut tables. So I have data that lives somewhere else. I've virtualized it into Wendlink by creating these shortcuts. So these sales tables are pointing to an Amazon S3 bucket, but using the shortcuts, I'm able to pull them here into my lakehouse and then grant users access to just specific shortcut items.
So this is like the logical view of data that's available, but it could be coming from Amazon, it could be coming from an ADLS Gen 2 storage.
And because it's part of a shortcut, I can grant users access to it. Now, you'll notice this table is grayed out. It's also a shortcut. And the reason this is grayed out is because this is data that already lives in Wendlink. We have this principle in Wendlink of one copy. So when you bring data into Wendlink, you don't have to then duplicate it if you want to use it somewhere else. You can create shortcuts to items in Wendlink. And when I do that, I inherit the security of the original data. So I can't redefine who has access to that data in this lakehouse because this is data that somebody has already secured. So I can create a shortcut to it, but I can't change who can access that data. Any other user who already had access to this table can see it when they go to my lakehouse. But if they didn't have access to that lakehouse, coming to my lakehouse, this bronze lakehouse here, isn't going to let them see it.
And there's no way to say like, okay, they've allowed like the sales group to access to it, but I can't give it a subset of that.
No, not at the moment.
Okay.
So I've chosen a few of my tables here, and then maybe I want to grant access to some of this unstructured data. When you grant access to a folder, we automatically grant access to all of the sub items. You can see I got my training data, and we just recursively grant access to those items. And the other thing to note here is this preview only supports read permission at the moment. You'll notice when I'm checking the boxes, there's not like something telling you what permission am I granting. We're just granting users read access when you check the box. If the box is not checked, they don't have read access to this.
If that's something you really want in terms of write access, head over to ideas.fabric.microsoft.com and let the product team know what you want and or any other items that you feel is missing from this. If you want to give that feedback, definitely go to the ideas site. We'll have links down in the description below.
Cool. So with that, let's go ahead and save our role definition, and then this will now be updated. But I haven't granted anybody access to it yet. So we'll click on the assign role button. Here we have two main ways of granting users access. The main way that you'll do here is this add people or groups. So let's go ahead and give Adam access here to this role. Add him, and then he shows up here as a member of this group. And you'll notice here that Adam doesn't have any access. This is the lakehouse permission. So as a separate step, I need to make sure that Adam has access to this lakehouse. So I can share the lakehouse, add Adam as a viewer to the workspace. So we'll do that here in a second to kind of complete the story. You can also add groups or service principles or manage identities as well. The other way you can add users is by virtualizing based off of their lakehouse permission. Mm. So you might have a group of users that already had the read all permission. That was the permission that was used without prior to the preview to grant users access to the data here in OneLike. I don't remember who they are. I don't want to like re-look up their names and add them here. You can just select read all, and we'll just go find everybody who had the read all permission on this Lighthouse and then add them dynamically as a member of this role. So that's kind of my recommendation. Use this to get started, and then when you're ready, you can kind of uncheck it and then just give users access to those individual items.
It's a static entry, right? So you can't say, oh, remove this person. It's not like adding them to the list as an individual item. It's a collection based on the selection you made, right?
That's correct. So if I wanted to go ahead and remove Matthew, who showed up on the list, I would have to go and remove Matthew's permissions from the Lighthouse itself.
And or add you explicitly and then remove that read all access.
Correct.
Got it.
Yep.
Okay.
So once I'm happy with my role definition, I can go ahead and click save. And then once you do that, boom, it's live. Now I called out, I didn't actually share the Lighthouse with you.
Yeah.
So let's go ahead and do that real quick.
Gotta help me out.
So at the top of the Lighthouse, there's a share button. And when you share a Lighthouse, there's a really important detail here, and that is don't check any boxes. This is the additional permission. You don't actually need to check any boxes to give user access. And so when we do this, we grant access. Adam will now be able to see this Lighthouse, connect to it, and then the data that Adam sees is going to be governed by this role here. So if I go back to this role and go to the Assign tab, we'll now see that you have read access to the Lighthouse. And when you go to access the Lighthouse, you'll just see the tables that we granted access to. You may or may not see this table, depending on whether or not you have access to the other Lighthouse where this data is. And then you'll see all of our unstructured data showing up.
So before you would have defined the role, if you would have shared the Lighthouse with me, I would have seen like the Lighthouse in the list, but I wouldn't have seen any data when I connected to it. It would have just been empty.
Correct. Right? When you open in it, you'll just see empty tables and files folder.
Now, is that an approach someone could take also by leveraging this and just removing that default role that was there and like, okay, cool, I can share this out now, but they don't get access to the files. That's just a way to potentially lock it down. Okay. And then what happens in the scenario with the additional permissions? I've typically known like the Spark access allows you to get access to the files as well, like through notebooks and whatnot. Does this govern that at all, or is that a separate piece?
It does. This governs OneLike access. So if you go through the Lighthouse UX, that is the OneLike view, right? You see the tables, but they're represented as the actual folders and files that exist in OneLike.
Got it.
Same thing if you go through a Spark notebook. You're accessing, you might be accessing a table, but the calls itself are going to OneLike. If you go through our OneLike File Explorer app, security will apply there as well. If you go through your SQL endpoint, that's governed by SQL security. So it's important to, when you do share your Lighthouse with users with that share dialog, there's an option in there for like granting SQL access. So if you have security set for your SQL users, make sure you share the SQL view with them and not the OneLike view with them.
Yeah, and if you guys want to learn more about how to do that, go check out a video I did a while back on controlling access to the Lighthouse. So this is kind of like an extension to that video. A lot of our audience is Power BI, and so Power BI DirectLink as well would not be, because it's looking at that logical view, right? So
that's correct.
It wouldn't be governed by this OneLake files and folder access.
One thing that is governed by this that's really cool is shortcuts. Maybe you have teams that are downstream consumers. They have their own workspaces, and you want them to use some data. So what you can do with this is create a role, grant users access to just a few items in that Lighthouse. They can go to their own workspace, maybe where they have elevated permissions, like they're a contributor, and they can write and create their own reports or Lighthouses. They can then use that to create shortcuts to the data you granted them access to, but only the data that you granted them access to.
Oh, that's nice. So instead of that all or nothing approach, which was there before, it's pared down to you get access to what you need and no more. That could be very powerful in terms of a governance approach, and especially if they're compounding that through control through security groups as well. And now you've got a managed way to give access to certain things. All right, Aaron, are there any like gotchas or things you need to be aware of when leveraging this?
Yeah, so there's one important detail here. So if I flip back over to the assign role page, you'll notice that a couple of the users that I added have this little warning triangle. This means, hey, these users have write permission. So they're an admin or a member or a contributor on this workspace. And so for these users, they're not restricted by the access that's set in the role. So even though I added Aaron and Matthew to this role, because they both have write access, they'll still see all of the items in the Lighthouse, kind of like they would in the previous world. So that's why it's really important to leverage the share control or put people in the viewer role if you only want them to see specific items. You can kind of solve that problem by creating a couple different workspaces and using those shortcuts.
And there's layers, right? So it's be intentional about where you're putting access and how you're giving people rights to that. So between workspace roles and then this feature inside of OneLake, as well as even on the TDS layer, like there's different ways you can apply security. So be aware of those options. I'll also have a link down in the description below to a newly published Fabric Security white paper. So definitely go check that out as well. That's got a ton of great information in it. All right, Aaron, thank you so much for being here. If you want to learn more about this feature, check out the link down in the description below. Again, if you have ideas for what you want to see as part of OneLake and security, go to ideas.fabric.microsoft.com. The product team is listening to you. And be sure to comment in the comment section for any questions you may have. We'll try to answer as many as we can. All right, Aaron, thanks for being here. Thank you everyone for watching. You are awesome, and we'll see you in the next video.